In the last lesson, we talked about the death of Vladimir Lenin. We talked about the fact that there was a power struggle that was left as a result of the fact that there was no clear leader. We also noted that the power struggle began before he died, which I'm sure he was very happy about. And this lesson is going to just introduce the power struggle that begins within the Communist Party. We're going to talk about all of the main figures, some of the more minor figures that had something of an influence but weren't touted as being significant in terms of their ability to win power. We'll talk about their ideological positions, we'll talk about their positions within the Communist Party, and then we will start to get to looking at how we have managed to eventually whittle our way down to a single individual, who is of course Joseph Stalin, who is on screen right now. So the death of Lenin, and the at least before the death of Lenin, as early as 1921, the Communist Party begin to initiate their power struggle. It eventually leads to Joseph Stalin taking and assuming power, becoming dictator, and this power struggle lasts until around 1929. In the next lesson, in this lesson, should I say, we're going to explore the ideological beliefs, the ideological debates, and the leadership struggles which existed within the party. We're going to look at the following members of the Politburo individually, okay? So we have seven individuals that we're going to focus on. We'll begin with the ultimate winner. Spoiler alert, Stalin ends up on top. And we will then go to looking at Trotsky, Tomsky, Bukharin, Kamenev, Rykov, and Zinoviev. All of these individuals had a certain play in terms of their positioning and their attempts to become leader of the Soviet Union after the death of Lenin. So who was Joseph Stalin? We haven't really spoken about Stalin other than when we noted when he came back to the Soviet Union during the Russian Revolution. We haven't actually noted anything significant about him, which is quite interesting given the fact that we're going to spend the vast, vast, vast majority of the rest of this series of lessons talking about Joseph Stalin. Well, Stalin was born in Georgia in 1879, the country Georgia, not the state in America, Georgia. He was an agitator and a fundraiser within the Bolshevik Party. He was sent to Serbia many times as a result. He was exiled many, many times, just like a number of these individuals were. And he joined the Bolsheviks at the very beginning and was loyal to Lenin through the whole period from 1903 to 1921. So you might think, well, this is actually a good candidate for leader, given the fact that Lenin also held Stalin in very high regard. He referred to Stalin as the quote, as that quote, wonderful Georgian. And so, therefore, they were very, very close. He was very loyal from the very beginning, and he was held in very high regard. Lenin supported Stalin's promotion to the position of General Secretary in 1921. So this is really where Stalin begins as his position as leader within the party. He begins as the General Secretary in 1921 and then makes his way to the top from there. We see that he is held in high regard, despite the fact that he is considered and at least criticized very heavily by Lenin in his testament, which we obviously note does not get read to the rest of the Communist Party. Next, we have Trotsky. Trotsky was born in 1883 and was known for being a talented writer and a very talented orator. He was the most famous member of the government other than Lenin because he was so vital, not only in the Russian revolutions, but also when we talk about the Russian Civil War. Despite being popular with Lenin, he was unpopular within the rest of the Communist Party. He had joined the Bolsheviks in 1917, promoting many to believe that he was simply seeking power and he did not really adhere to the true Leninist ideas that were being perpetuated as early as 1903, for example. So given the fact that he only really joined during the revolution, creates the idea, the impression in some, that he actually didn't really believe many of the things that he was touting. He in fact just wanted to take power and take control, and so he wasn't a true ideologue. He retained his position on the Politburo until 1927, and he was unable, essentially, to influence policy to a great extent. And so when we talk about his writing and his orating, that is really where his talents grew and his ability to coordinate and to bring and to essentially invigorate individuals onto his beliefs is something that he was very talented at. But in terms of influencing policy, he was less talented. Kamenev is the next of our individuals. He was a committed Bolshevik and had been a committed Bolshevik since 1905. He was initially close to Lenin, but one of the things that caused them to grow apart was the fact that he opposed Lenin's April thesis of 1917. Remember back to the lesson when we looked at the provisional government and we looked at the February Revolution, the April thesis of 1917 promised peace, land and bread, all the three things that Lenin failed to actually achieve. He formed what became known as the triumvirate between him, Zinoviev, and Stalin to essentially prevent Trotsky from becoming the most powerful. This was done in 1922. So this is really when we're in the full swing of the leadership struggle, which begins in 1921. And so ultimately, Kamenev was very clear that he did not want Trotsky to be leader, and so he formed essentially a pact with Zinoviev and with Stalin to prevent Trotsky from becoming more powerful and from assuming authority. And speaking of Zinoviev, let's think about what Zinoviev actually contributed to the power struggle. He was a close friend of Lenin, and he was a true ideological Leninist. So he was truly alongside the ideological beliefs of Lenin himself. He had supported the Bolshevik movement from the very beginning, and again, he led this group and formed a majority on the Politburo. So this group was formed with Stalin and Kamenev, and he would lead the group and form a majority on the Politburo against Trotsky. We know already Trotsky was not very popular within the rest of the Communist Party. He was popular with Lenin, but not with anybody else. And so as a result of this, it was becoming very clear that even though he was the most popular in terms of his name recognition, he would be very quickly singled out as the person to attack in this power struggle. Which is essentially what we see. In an effort to ensure that Trotsky would not become the new leader, he made a number of speeches which would outline the differences between Lenin and Trotsky in terms of their ideological beliefs, which I think is quite petty personally, but is quite funny in terms of the context of which this is taking place. Clearly trying to ensure that Trotsky does not become a leader within the Politburo. So a couple of the more minor figures that we're going to spend a tiny bit of time on here include Tomsky and Rykov. So Tomsky was born in 1880 and had a background in the trade union movement. So he had a background in the relationship to workers' rights, but not necessarily a Bolshevik straight away. He was the chairman of the Central Council of Trade Unions in 1918, and despite this, he had clashed with Lenin over the role that trade unions would play within society. So essentially, the idea of Bolshevism was far more extreme than what Tomsky would essentially would align himself with, even though he became a communist as time went on, owing to his allegiances to the trade union movement. Corin was born in 1888, and from 1925 to early 1928, he was considered to be the most prominent figure within the Soviet government. So this had him as maybe potentially a favorite to take power and authority during the power struggle. He joined the Bolshevik Party in 1906 and was a true Leninist, a true ideologue, a true ideological believer in the Leninist movement. He supported Lenin consistently until his death in 1924, and he was trusted by Lenin for a number of important tasks, signifying the fact that he was obviously very close to Lenin because they had known each other for a very long time and had very similar ideological beliefs. So, for example, he was editor of Pravda, which was a Soviet newspaper. And so as a result of this, this is clearly an example of one of the important tasks which Lenin supported Bukharin in being able to do, essentially. Despite this, it is known that him and Lenin would often disagree on a number of policy issues. So, for example, they disagreed on ending the First World War. Bukharin did not want it to end. Lenin did. And they also disagreed on the introduction of the NEP, the New Economic Policy. Obviously, Lenin did want it to be implemented. Bukharin did not. Last but not least, or in fact, actually last but least, we can think about Rykov. So Rykov was born into a peasant family in 1881. He was elected to succeed Lenin as chairman of the Sovnarkom and prime minister of the USSR. He also supported the NEP. Rykov gets knocked out quite early in terms of his contribution to the power struggle and the leadership struggle. So I sort of tacked him on at the end here, supporting the NEP, which we will get to the reason why that is unpopular and actually a detriment to his ability to become leader later on. But he was also supposedly elected to succeed Lenin as chairman of the Sovnarkom and also prime minister of the USSR.